Hi everyone, welcome to Fast Charge. I am your host Dom, back from a week off last week where I went to very sunny Naples, which was lovely, except that I caught a vicious, horrible, long-lived cold. So I'm really sorry if you can hear that in my voice. I'm like right at the tail end of this awful disease that I worried was, you know, the bad one, but apparently not. Multiple negative tests, so I'm fine. Just a little sniffly. But
we know
we're
the truth
get through
is
it.
You just knocked back way too many limoncellos, too much cheesy pizza.
I wish.
Yeah.
No, I was too sick to have any limoncello. I didn't have any at all. I sort of tapped myself to like one glass of wine a day because I thought any more than that might just set me back on this plague. But no, I am back this week, joined by Lewis, Toddy, and Chris, making a somewhat rare appearance because he's going to join us to chat about all things Amazon. So this week's big topic will be Amazon's event. They held one of their sort of annual product launches where they unveiled a slew of weird and wonderful things, including an actual robot, though it's a bit rubbish. Chris was actually sitting watching the event, so he'll be running us through everything Amazon announced. We're also going to talk about Xiaomi's new, I think it's Civi, I think that's how I pronounce it, C-I-V-I, which is their new mid-range phone. They've just launched in China. It's sort of a rebranding of what used to be their CC line. So maybe it's a CV, is how I'm meant to say it. I'm not really sure. Anyway, we're going to run through what that is, what it looks like, and whether it's going to make it outside of China at all. And then finally, we're going to talk all things Galaxy S22, which I know is still a while off, but this week has been a big week for S22 stuff because OnLeaks went and dropped his first renders of all three models in the S22 line, which also simultaneously revealed a lot of new info we didn't have. We had a few leakers corroborating bits and some very unexpected rumors about what these phones are actually going to be called, because it may not be what you're expecting. Before that, let's turn to a few little bits and pieces from this week. First off, something from the last day or so, the Nintendo Switch Pro or Switch 2, or Switch 4K, or new Nintendo Switch 2 4K Pro, whatever it's going to be, it may exist after Nintendo has vehemently insisted that it doesn't. Bloomberg ran a report just yesterday basically saying that as many as 11 game development companies, and that's just the ones they could verify, but they say employees at 11 different dev companies say they have 4K Switch dev kits, implying that they're is a 4K Switch on the way, or at the very least there was one on the way, and enough so that Nintendo sent dev kits out. You may remember they instead announced the Switch OLED, a model that does not support 4K output. That launches in just a week or two. I think it's next Friday that one comes out. Nintendo, unsurprisingly, has denied this immediately, which it kind of has to, because it's about to launch a new non-4K console. And if it admitted it had something 4K in the works, all sales of the OLED model would just tank because no one would buy it if they knew there was a 4K console around the corner. But yeah, it looks now increasingly likely that all those leaks about a pro model with 4K support were probably real, but the component shortages across the industry set it back. It's now maybe coming next year, Bloomberg thinks, late in 2022. But Nintendo says this is absolute nonsense. It's not working on any other Switch models whatsoever. Which is itself gives away the lie, because there is no way they're not working on any new Switch hardware.
They're doing something.
It's just what?
Nothing to see here, guys. So,
yeah.
It's going to be called the Swatch Pro.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
It's worth, you know, caveating all this with you know, Nintendo does this. So I think asked about Switch hardware earlier this year, one of their senior execs said, we are not launching any new Switch hardware anytime soon. And then within a month or two, they announced the Switch OLED. And it's like, yeah, this is just, it's how Nintendo does.
Yeah.
So we'll see. pretty much, they're willing to. Also this week, Withings announced a new version of their ScanWatch smartwatch, the Withings ScanWatch Horizon. Toddy, I know you sort of wrote this up, so you'll have all the details. This is basically the ScanWatch, but in a more premium body for a more substantial price. Is that fair?
That's exactly it. Yep. Same kind of hardware, same feature set, same battery life. So I think it's like 30 days on a charge. You got ECG functionality with AFib or unregular heart rate detection. You've got sleep tracking with apnea, sleep apnea prediction, mm-hmm. All of that good stuff. But yes, it looks kind of like, if you know your luxury kind of diving watches, it's that kind of aesthetic. So it has some bolder elements on the front. It's a lot bolder than the standard scan watch in terms of design. It comes pre-fitted with a metal strap, but also has a sporty kind of fluoro elastomer strap as well. It looks pretty nice. It's got glow-in-the-dark elements on the front as well, just like you would get on a diving watch, which is quite cool.
It's that slightly sort of chunky metal aesthetic associate with Rolexes and that sort of space.
They pitched it as like kind of like it evokes the, was it the Rolex? I want to get them the right way around. The Rolex Submariner and the Omega Seamaster, I think, are the Rangers.
I wouldn't know, I'll be honest.
I knew only once I looked it up for the article. But yes, it went
one
on
of those
sale.
Seamaster.
Seamaster. Although if I was making a watch brand, I would definitely use Seamaster. 100%. The watches, the Horizon went on sale on September 29th in Europe and Asia. And they're still trying to get the original scan watch out in the US. It's still not available in the US. It's still marked as coming soon because they're waiting on FDA approval for some of those features. So the Horizon, if it gets that approval, will be launching alongside the standard model in the US.
I like the scan watch a lot. I reviewed it for us. I'm a big fan of the Withings watches because I personally don't love smartwatches that much. I don't want constant notifications and things like that. They don't do it for me. But I love having something that's a step tracker, has all this heart rate stuff, all of these, you know, health features, but looks for the most part like a regular watch. For me, the standard scan watch is kind of the watch aesthetic I like, actually. I don't love the look of the Horizon, but I know a lot of people love those kind of watches, and so I can see a lot of people jumping on this immediately. Cool. Next up, I'm going to pivot back to Lewis now, because I sort of made the list of news for this week, and then Lewis pointed out I'd missed that there were some Oculus Quest 2 Pro leaks. And Lewis gave me a quick précis of what those leaks were, and I barely understood a word of it. It involved lucid dreaming. So what on earth has happened, Lewis?
It's been a weird week for the Quest 2 Pro. It's been rumored a lot recently. There's a lot of references to it in recent Oculus firmware updates. So we know that something's cooking. This week's interesting because it started off at the weekend. I think it was the weekend. And there was this leaked screenshot, which looked like it was from like a Facebook Workplaces video meeting where somebody whose face is pixelated is showing off what looks to be a new Oculus Touch controller. People weren't too sure about that because it's the first time we'd seen anything like that. And then a couple of days later, someone on Reddit then shared kind of low-res graphics, which looked identical. And we thought that was it. Absolutely fine. But the guy went a step further and he said that he then had lucid dreams, which for those who don't know what lucid dreams are, it's dreams where you're asleep, but you're awake. You're aware that you're dreaming. And somehow in this lucid dream, he says that he saw detailed specs for the Oculus Quest 2 Pro and outlined the different technology it's going to have and all the different features it's going to have. And I don't know why people are reporting on this. Somebody please explain to me why people are taking lucid dreams seriously.
I really hope it turns out to be absolutely perfect. Oh, 100%. Spot on. Every single detail correct. I'd love it if he's, you know, actually, you know, gotten this info from a reputable source or something and is just bored of the normal, like, anonymous source says, you know, Molly, could you do this? Just play around with where they're claiming to have got this, you know.
I got it
in a lucid dream.
In a dream.
Abraham Lincoln appeared to me in a dream and told me the Oculus specs. Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, let's get more leaks from dreams, from trips, from mushrooms, LSD.
Yeah, for sure.
I want people to claim they found a bit of paper down the back of the sofa that turned out to have the specs of the PlayStation 6 on.
Shapes in the clouds.
Yeah.
Let's get creative with it. Why not? Let's spice it up a little bit. So just to summarize, or just to say, Facebook says no Oculus Quest 2 Pro this year. They've said that for a while, but it's looking more likely that they're going to announce something at Facebook Connect in October. So watch this space.
Cool. Exciting. Also coming in October, the Honor 50, which was launched in China earlier this summer, but Honor has now finally confirmed the global launch, which had always said it was going to give this phone a global launch. It now actually, we have a date, October 26th, there is going to be an actual global, by which they mostly mean European and bits of Asia, launch for the Honor 50 phone, which lest we forget, is the first Honor phone that will be shipping globally with Google mobile services. So this is a big deal. Honor's actually come on leaps and bounds in China since it was sold by Huawei. It just the other day was reported to be the third biggest smartphone brand in China right now. Man. So they've had a huge resurgence in the Chinese market. So I think we've got to take seriously the prospect that they may have a big future globally as well as an independent brand. It's worth mentioning, I don't think it came up on the show before, but there was also a little thing a while ago where the US, people in the US were beginning to talk about whether they might throw Honor, the new independent Honor, onto the same entity list that Huawei is on.
Oh, wow.
Honor was only sold to free it from the entity list, but there is still some concern that it's fundamentally still state-owned and thus belongs on that list. So this may all be short-lived, I'm afraid. In theory, the Honor 50 is coming globally on October 26th, which is exciting. They also had an event in China just the other day where they announced a few new MagicBook laptops, including some of the first laptops in the world that are going to ship with Windows 11 out of the box, and a new Honor Pad 7 or V7, I can't remember exactly, a new Honor tablet. So they're sort of building steam on their releases again, which is good to see. And then finally, while that phone is coming, there's another one that we thought was, but maybe is not, which is the Galaxy S21 FE. This obviously is this is the fan edition version of the S21. It's been a beleaguered phone. Leaks have been back and forth the last few months about whether it was coming, whether it was getting delayed, was it getting cancelled, was it not getting cancelled. It looked like for a while they were targeting an August launch along with the foldables, then it became an October launch. It's now basically come out that Samsung had planned a Galaxy Unpacked event for it in October, but has now cancelled that event. Support pages that had been erroneously put up for the phone have now been taken down, even though they've been up for ages. So everyone's sort of reading a lot into this that the phone isn't coming out. We're not sure, basically. Some leakers are saying that they're still going to release the phone. They just might not give it a big, glamorous Unpacked event. If that happens, that presumably means it's only hitting certain markets or in very limited quantities, and they may really... Potentially the message they'll take is they'll double down on the fan edition thing. This will be really like a limited edition for the fans drop. I could see them playing it that way. Yeah. But it basically seems like, again, component shortages. They have not been able to build enough of these. And part of the recent speculation is because it uses the Snapdragon 888, or at least we expect it to. And that chip is also in the Z Flip 3, which apparently has been selling beyond Samsung's expectations. And so there's partly been a question internally of, where do they assign those chips when they've got a limited number? Do they put them in the new unreleased phone, or do they throw them into this flagship foldable that is already selling very well? And it sounds like maybe they decided to reserve them for the flip. So if you're holding out for the S21 FE, I'd give it another couple of weeks, then we'll kind of know for sure, but it's not looking all that good, I'm afraid. Okay, we will return to Samsung later in the show to talk about the S22. But first, let's turn to Seattle for all things Amazon. Chris, you watched Samsung's launch event this week where they unveiled at least 10 different products or something like that. What are the big ones, though? What are the highlights?
Yeah, there was quite a lot. Although Jim, who is our sort of Amazon expert, was sort of expecting more. Even though the event was like just over an hour, so I think they packed in quite a lot.
We didn't get was a standard Echo update, which I think a lot of people thought we were going to get the fifth gen Echo, and didn't.
The Echo Dot 5 and all that kind of stuff. Whether that will happen before Christmas, don't know, maybe. But let's talk about Astro first, shall we? Which is Amazon's little big one. Sort of cute robot Alexa thing. It's like a tablet on wheels with mics, speakers, cameras, all that kind of jazz that's incredibly expensive and doesn't seem to be able to do all that much.
It's a funny one. It's incredibly expensive. It's $1,500 that they'll be doing the first run at just $1,000. Yes. It's funny because if you said a robot for $1,500, I'm like, affordable. And then you say the things Astro does and you're like, oh, no. Yes. It's just, it does feel a lot like an Echo Show on wheels with a little bucket at the back that you can put some crisps in.
Yeah.
The pitch is odd.
Yeah, so it's it's built on Alexa, but they've given it this other personality, which is, I guess, why it's called Astro. So like the tablet can move around and it has eyes and, you know, emotes at you like robots that we've seen, you know, 20 years ago.
I enjoy the face design because it immediately made me think of it's a niche pull, but if anyone's seen Next Gen on Netflix, it is a story about basically these home robots that turn into some sort of robot uprising or revolts against humanity. So the fact that it has the same face is just beautiful. Genius.
It's got a very Jibo vibe, if anyone remembers Jibo.
Jibo, no.
It was the virtual assistant before Siri and Google and all those came along. It had a screen and it had a face exactly like this, and it emoted and stuff like that. And people bought them, kickstarted it, backed it, and then they closed the servers down a few years later because they couldn't compete. So Jibo is dead.
It basically smacks of something that they've been working on for a long time. So all of the tech is quite basic, so that even the tablet is, you know, the screen is not even full HD. The camera on that bit is, let me just check the megapixels. It's not very high megapixel camera. Yeah,
I mean, it's very telling that even Amazon, it feels like they don't really know what this is for, and they're kind of releasing it in the hope that they're going to find out what it's for once people start buying it. Yeah. Because there is this introductory offer for, you know, $500 off if you buy the, and this is pitched very much as like a trial period to kind of like it really, the way they're pushing it feels like they're basically saying like, if people could just buy them and start using them, we'll figure out how you're using them. And then we'll make the next one better because it will focus on the ways people actually use this thing.
Yeah. And the presenter guy, you know, he said he's been using it for a year. So I don't know how he hasn't come up with some things for it to do. But it's basically a little smart display that roams around your house. It can't go up and downstairs, though. So if you want it upstairs and it's downstairs, well, you're screwed.
And even worse than that, there were some comments this week that came allegedly from former developers on the project who were presumably no longer there, or maybe they still are, but they were talking anonymously. But basically, people who know what it is spoke to Vice, and the quotes are, one called it terrible, one called it a disaster that's not ready for release. Someone else said that the pitch that it could be an accessibility device useful sort of giving to like elderly grandparents or something was absurdist nonsense. And that the best was that doubling down on this question, it can't do stairs, it can't go up or downstairs. But more than that, they said that if presented the opportunity, it would throw itself down stairs.
Is it sentient? It's just had enough of this already. It's like, please.
Yeah. It's worth saying Amazon has denied all of this vociferously. Amazon is like, no, this is true. None of these quotes are real. You know, we don't know who these people are, but essentially they have said this is nonsense.
You'd hope it wouldn't fall downstairs because robot vacuum cleaners can avoid going downstairs, and this uses basically similar tech. So
Amazon itself does exactly say it's designed to detect stairs and stop the device where and when necessary. I mean, my guess is these quotes are probably real. These probably are real devs, but they're, like you said, Chris, this feels like Amazon have been building it for years. Yeah. And yes, probably when this, you know, someone was working on it a year or two ago, maybe then it didn't do stairs well. I assume by the point they're willing to charge a grand for it, probably by now it can at least not hurl itself downstairs all the time.
Yeah, it's
but we won't know. We won't know till these get out there.
It's got depth sensors. It's got infrared LEDs to, you know where it is and stuff. So I'd hope so. Other than sort of taking, you know, they gave, you know, example of like putting some snacks in the back and saying take this to whoever. Other than that, it's basically like a roaming sort of security device, you know, with cameras, so you can check in on your house, you know, like you would with any other number of cameras, but you can drive it around the house, you know, to check on different rooms. It sort of seems to be able to patrol around perhaps at night, you know, checking on all the rooms that it can access so that if it detects it, and the thing that it considers to be unusual, it can let you know. And this is done via a little periscope camera that pops up on a little telescopic rod so that it's not just limited to sort of, you know, looking around the floor. So that's like,
it's
a just, wide,
it's red flag-tastic, this thing, isn't it? Just like wide, everything it camera. Does just sounds concerning or problematic in some way.
It's sounding more and more similar to that Ring quadcopter thing that was supposed to take off and
that they talked about last year, right?
Yeah.
I think that's out now. I think you can buy that.
Can you?
That was one of the other products they talked about.
Oh, there we go.
So that is called the Amazon Halo View, and it's a security camera that takes off and flies around your house. So what? Nothing could go wrong there, I'm sure.
Yeah. Nothing.
I mean, you know, the only good thing I can say about this really is that at least it isn't made by Facebook.
Amazon's so much better, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's a close second, though, isn't it, really?
it does. I just struggle because I really do think I can't see what Amazon doesn't feel like it's communicated what this is for. Yeah. And there's partly this kind of, oh, it's a security device. It's partly this, oh, it's for carrying, you know, snacks around to the family members. Okay, weird. Partly they're like, it's an accessibility device. Buy it for your grandparents or, you know, disabled family members or something. So it's a, you know, moving thing that will help them and also an easy way to communicate with them. Okay, maybe, but they need to pick one thing and say it can do this, it does it really well, and prove that it does. And right now it feels like they're just throwing it out and being like, I don't know, it's got a screen, it moves around, it'll do some stuff. We'll
figure it out. Yeah.
I cannot see why anyone would buy this. Even like the accessibility thing, they just haven't really pitched like, well, how does it help my grandma if I give her this little like roving robot? I don't understand. Yeah. I don't understand what she gets out of that experience.
A robot in the home at the best of times is a hard pitch. So not being able to pitch it with a purpose.
And £1,000 price tag.
They seem to be pitching it more for the person who is responsible for that elderly person rather than the elderly person themselves. So that you can, you know, drop in on the robot and like go find them and see if they're okay and, you know, that kind of thing, rather than just hoping they'll, you know, be near their Echo Show or whatever.
Right. Yeah.
It's a very expensive, you know, untested, you know, way of looking after somebody via a robot.
And if someone with accessibility concerns adding a new moving trip hazard that into their house doesn't sound like the right answer.
They showed it in a, you know, promotion videos weaving around a dog and stuff like this, but you know, it's a very relaxed dog. Like my dog would freak out if that thing came in the house.
Okay, so the Astro is a little odd, but Amazon did announce some more normal products as well. I think the other big one probably is the Echo Show 15, right? Which is an interesting one because it took me totally by surprise, but then afterwards immediately makes total sense what they've done with it. And you go, oh, yeah, cool. All right, I get that.
We should probably add just on the Astro that it's only shipping in the US and it's like one of the invite-only Amazon devices. So it's not like this is going on sale, you know, globally.
And lucky for you, will get an invitation to spend $1,000 to have a robot that they don't know what to do with.
I'm so gutted now that you've told me that.
But the Echo Show... so this is the Echo Show 15, and this is probably the Amazon product of the last few years I would actually consider buying, maybe.
Yeah.
And I'm more of a Google guy on the whole. So this is it's like an Echo Show but wall mountable, so it looks a bit like Samsung's TV, which is called the Frame. So it's got a nice black bezel. It's 15.6 inch screen, like a full size laptop. So you've got a decent amount of real estate there. Like a lot of smart displays are quite small, so feel a little bit fiddly. You can wall mount it in portrait as well as landscape.
That's nice.
Depending on where you're putting it. So like if you do have, you know, a house where, you know, you've got a small kitchen, but you want something in there, but there isn't really any worktop space, you know, it goes on the wall. It's got speakers, mic, front-facing camera. One of the main things Amazon has added is called Visual ID, which is basically the same thing as the Google Nest Hub Max. So basically the camera can recognize different users. So when you go up and start using it, it'll be like, oh, hey, Chris, and then it'll bring up all of my content, my calendar, my reminders, all that kind of stuff. But yeah, it's basically an Echo Show, you know, for the home, for everybody to use. You can leave different family members reminders or sticky notes or different things. You know, there's a shared calendar so you can see what everybody's up to that day. Basically, it's like a digital whiteboard, organizer, calendar, everything, you know, to replace that physical calendar, all those sticky notes that you'd normally have on the wall, on the fridge, for $249, which is, yeah, seems quite good.
The wall mounting also makes it, I think, the best expression yet of that pitch of it as a photo frame as well, which has always, yeah, been part of the thing with these smart displays and Echo Shows. Yeah. But actually, this is a smart looking bit of kit that goes on the wall, nice big display, and you can essentially obviously have all these widgets for usability, but then in between you can have essentially, you know, a screensaver that is cycling through, you know, whatever photos you've chosen to have that will show full screen. And that's, you know, an appealing option on the little frames, but actually if you're going to have a big thing wall mounted in the living room or something, you need, you know, you want it to look nice the rest of the time. And actually this is, you know, it, getting closer and closer to finally killing the small digital photo frame business, because this is a great version of that. It's also hell for the Netgear mural, which is Netgear's extraordinarily overpriced big wall mountable digital screen that displays photos and art. And this is the same thing for half the price with no ongoing subscription fee. Ugh. Just for the right to put your photos on the wall. So sorry, yeah, I think this kills the mural for good, but that's
really want
best.
One in my bathroom, because you know everyone talks about smart bathroom mirror. Like, I'd love to be able to put a mirror finish on that and just whack it up in the bathroom, because that just seems like a perfect place. You know, like when you get up in the morning, you get your day broken down for you while you're brushing your teeth and stuff.
Oh, it's going to happen. Yeah.
100%.
It'll happen. They just have to build it to deal with the humidity.
Yeah,
and
that's the thing,
and
isn't
the
it?
Moisture, don't they? That's the problem.
I'm just curious to see what you get in the box in terms of the wall mounting stuff, because I think cable management, it looks like it just has the one power cable, which is nice. Mm-hmm. But like for me, having to run cables like from a picture effectively, like where you place a picture, like usually it's not always near a plug point. It's usually got to go down and then like along your skirting. So how will they handle that? I'm kind of intrigued to see what comes in box. And also at 15 inches, the UI they were showing off, the font and everything looks quite small. And I don't know whether you'll be able to change that in accessibility. Yeah. You probably will. But they mentioned a hallway. I could see a hallway or a small kitchen in a lounge or a bigger room in your house. It might not be that functional unless you're willing to always go right up to it, even to glance at it for information. So I think I wouldn't be surprised if this is the start of a bigger series of
frames. For sure. This is, and you know, I think this is telling of both this and actually Astro. And, you know, one of the points Amazon made about Astro was this is their first robot, but not their last one. Right. And I think this is kind of the same thing here. This is obviously, we've had a few Echo Shows before, but this feels like a new subcategory within the Echo Shows. And absolutely, this is the first one. I refuse to believe they're not already working on the Echo Show 20 and 30 or whatever, and we're going to get bigger wall filling versions of this that really push that photo angle hard. I wouldn't be surprised if they actually do start to work on bigger partnerships with sort of art companies to get, you know, custom artworks up and stuff like that, or art subscriptions. And equally, I think, you know, we at some point this will start to fuse with the TV side, where there are Amazon Fire TVs. And, you know, at some point they'll start building them to do some of this Echo Show UI on TVs by default, or sort of when the TV is in standby mode, things like that. It'll all start to fuse together. But there's going to be big versions of this.
It comes with the wall mounting kit. It's actually the countertop stand that is optional. So it is pitched as a wall mounted device. Yeah. I don't think there's anything comes, you know, to route the cable. It's going to go down the wall to the plug, basically.
And that's the problem with all this stuff, to be honest. Like I said, the Netgear mural has the same thing. I've got, you might be able to see behind me on camera, I've got the Sonos IKEA picture frame hanging up, and again, you just have a cable dangling down. Unless you want to, you know, drill holes into your wall to run your cables through the wall, you just have to do that. And as we have more and more wall mounted tech, we're all just going to have to get used to that, I think. unless someone comes up with some very clever ideas I haven't thought of. Okay, what else? We'll run quickly through some of the other announcements because I'm keen to move on to the Xiaomi and Samsung stuff today. But other little bits and bobs. One that is surprising when you realize this is their first, but they have made their first smart thermostat. And given that Google's had Nest for so long, it's sort of weird that Amazon hadn't officially had its own smart thermostat before, but it hadn't. So long overdue. But yeah, this is actually a partnership with Honeywell, the sort of energy and heating company that does their own smart thermostats, actually. But this is now a smarter Alexa integrated one that's also very affordable. It's only $50. I haven't looked deep enough to figure out what the catch is there, because
what's the data they're collecting on you.
Well, yes, but you know, even though that's very competitive compared to the Google Nest rivals, yeah. So I'm sure this is a simpler stripped back version. But again, probably part of a theme. This is Amazon's first smart thermostat. It's almost certainly not their last smart thermostat. The only funny thing there is they haven't branded it in any way. There's no, you know, it's not called the Echo Heat or something. They haven't sort of built a little mini brand for their thermostat stuff to go into. It's just the Amazon smart thermostat.
I think it's got Alexa integration, but I think the price is largely down to the very basic, like, screen on it. So it just sort of displays the temperature. There's up and down and sort of a okay button. I think that's about it.
What more do you need?
Whereas, well, the Nest shows you quite a lot, and you know, got the rotating dial, and you know,
dial is good.
Build quality. I think this is basically a plastic LCD screen, you know, on the wall.
But I'm sure we'll there'll be a premium version. There'll be more sort of fleshed out Nest rivals to come. Yeah. There's a new Blink video doorbell. The first for Blink. I don't really understand why we have both Blink and Ring, which I think Amazon owns both of.
Yep. They bought them both, right? They were both existing companies in their own right before.
They were,
once upon a time, is that right?
I think Blink is just the really cheap version.
Right.
They are kind of budget, like, entry-level cameras and stuff like that. Yep. Yeah.
The Halo View, which is a new fitness tracker, the follow-up to the Halo, that we didn't get a Halo 2.
But the tracker, so that they made a whole point about the fact it doesn't have a screen, and that's a good thing because it doesn't distract you. So they were like, but now screen.
This one's got a screen. Yeah. Because it turns out people actually quite want screens on fitness trackers, and cheaper rivals all had screens. And, you know, why buy the one without a screen when you can buy the one with one?
You can't pull the wool over our eyes, Jeff.
This one still feels like a hard sell because it's $80, which means it's much more expensive from things like Honor and Xiaomi's trackers. Yeah. It's more in the Fitbit price range. I can't really see why you'd go Amazon rather than Fitbit, given the choice.
The brand loyalty and isn't Amazon.
Although you have to subscribe, pay subscriptions for Fitbits now, don't you?
If you want all of the features, optional. I'm currently testing it without the premium on the Charge 5, but there is premium, which I'm going to activate in a bit and see how it differs. But so far, it seems to be a wholly usable product without the premium. Okay.
It's just that kind of new features Fitbit is coming up with, it tends to throw into the subscription. But all that core stuff they've always done, it's still there for free.
Well, yeah, you're really just paying for it processing your data in more ways and then giving you more numbers to work with, which is nice.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then the last announcement, I guess, worth briefly touching on is the Amazon Glow, which is this strange obelisk with a screen for playing games with children. It's one of the more ominous looking children's toys I've seen.
It's quite bizarre.
Yeah.
It's like a Facebook portal, but sort of
projected onto the table.
Yeah, with a projector that, so you can
sort of do interactive play
with
stuff.
Kids, I don't know.
That's true.
It's a little odd. But again, this is, I think, speaks to what a lot of this Amazon launch was, which is it's not them doing all the obvious things. Some of them maybe are the fitness tracker or the smart thermostat. But a lot of what they're doing right now feels like it's Amazon throwing its money into R&D and trying to, I don't know, come up with the next big thing before it is the next big thing. And so they're just, you know, throwing everything at the wall to see what sticks, I suppose. And as much as we make fun of it, I do want to, you know, give them some credit for that. I think it's good to have companies taking risks and coming up with new stuff like that and being a bit adventurous in what they put out into the market.
My reservation, like looking at the hardware for the Glow and kind of Astro as well to a lesser degree, that there's definitely an element like a company like Amazon should, I feel like it's kind of doing like testing, like product testing with consumers.
Yeah.
I feel like it has the money to get enough people in to do product testing before it then sells you a dev, basically a dev kit. I can't even say the word, developmental robot for £1,000 or $1,000 or where, however much the Glow costs. I don't know what the pricing is. Oh, $250.
$249,
yeah.
It's a bit high.
Yeah.
I mean, I kind of get it for like homeschooling if we're in another lockdown or something like that, but then 250 quid for that, you're not going to get many of them sold.
No, and it, you know, and it's very limited and its scope is very specific, and you know, it's not, it doesn't fit any universal standards or anything like that.
No,
I guess the tech is similar to like what we've seen from, I think Sony once did a projector which has a touch sensitive like area, but that was like I think over a grand. So in a sense, it's, the tech is getting cheaper at least, I suppose, but still unusual.
And again, unusual, but it does feel like another area where this is the first time they're going to make one of these.
For sure.
But even if this doesn't sell well, I still don't think this will be the last one. Okay. This is an odd gen where instead of getting the expected, you know, here's our fifth Echo, they're really throwing out, okay, here's our first of several different things. Yeah. And all of them do feel a little prototypey. And I think that's a very fair criticism that a company as big and rich as Amazon can probably afford to not release prototypes. Everything should be a bit more polished than this maybe before it hits the market.
For sure.
But it is what it is. Cool. Okay, let's move on to phone stuff since we are a phone show. The Xiaomi Civi or CV launched in China the other day. It's basically a new mid-range phone from Xiaomi. It's an unusual one for Xiaomi in that it's essentially a new product line. It's arguably a replacement for existing CC line, but it is a new brand, CV. But it also is one phone. There's no Lite or SE or Pro or Plus for now. I'm sure there will be. But right now, there is just one Xiaomi CV, and that is it. It's definitely a mid-range device. It's a Snapdragon 778G chipset. It's got a 120 hertz OLED display, but it's only Full HD Plus. It's got 55 watt wired charging, but I don't think it has wireless charging, though I'm not positive on that.
I think it's so thin, it doesn't have.
Yeah, and it has camera specs that are solid, but not jaw-dropping. But as Toddy alluded, the thinness is a big part of this. It is just under 7 millimeters thick. Is that right? Yeah, a hair under 7 millimeters and only weighs 166 grams, which for a phone with a 6.55 inch display is really impressive.
Yeah.
Like it's not a small phone, but it is very thin and very light.
I assume it's a plastic body to keep it that light.
I don't know.
It's always hard to know. They'd never tell you what the material is.
They're definitely not going to admit that it's plastic as well.
Yeah, but I can't find anything on the material, but I'm sure it must be plastic.
It's got to be for that weight. Yeah, I mean, you know, if it is that lightweight, I'd happily take that trade off. I think it's a novelty. Getting a phone.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of this stuff. It's a big part of I've always spoken about why I'm a big fan of the Vivo flagships, the Vivo X series, and also their V series. And I actually have the X70 Pro and Pro Plus here. I just haven't had a chance to play with them properly yet, so I didn't want to talk about them on the show yet until I've really given them a proper go. But part of what I've loved about those phones is Vivo tends to build them to be A, thin, and B, light. And it does make some compromises elsewhere, but I actually think it's something a lot of the big brands are kind of forgetting, that thin and light does matter. And especially as the market has sort of unanimously agreed big displays are a thing. And we've seen the iPhone 12 mini, you know, flop. And clearly people just, for all we talk about liking small phones, actually people aren't buying them. Clearly people do want big screens. But there are still ways to do a big screen and then make the rest of the phone feel thin and light.
Yeah.
As opposed to what we see in, you know, the Pro Maxes and the Ultra phones, which is big bricks.
Chunky.
Yeah. And there's a place for that. Obviously, there's a place for that phone that just is big because it does everything as best as it can. But I think if you're looking for a mid-range phone, if you're going to drop some of the specs down, like I would always rather have one that looks and feels this polished and premium. It's just a huge difference in how pleasant the phone feels to use and pick up and all of that. I was at a Xiaomi event the other day. I can't remember if we spoke about it or not on the show, but where I saw the Mi 11 Lite NE 5G.
Yes.
which was, you know, fundamentally just the Mi 11 Lite, but I'd never used the Mi 11 Lite. And compared to the 11T and the 11T Pro that were there, I just immediately fell in love more with the 11 Lite. Yeah. Because, yeah, it's much less powerful and arguably worse value, but you pick it up and you're like, this is a nice phone, even though it's actually pretty affordable.
This is light.
Yeah. But being light, being thin, like that matters, I think. I think it's very underestimated.
It really appeals to me. Like, I've missed the days of, you know, it sounds like we're talking about a phone that's come out in 2013, because that was, you know, the race back then was how thin and light can we get this thing.
Yeah.
You know, before the days of how many cameras can we put on the back, which, you know, now is just boring.
Yeah.
So it's nice to see at least somebody going back to that. Let's actually make this thing beautiful and nice to hold and nice to use. Like, it feels like we sort of lost that in the phone market to a large extent over the last, you know, five plus years.
I think it depends on what the sacrifice is. Like, because with the older, thinner phones, the sacrifice was always to battery life. And, you know, there were some phones that were just absolutely appalling on battery life because they wanted them to be thin and light. But yeah, as long as the battery life's still decent, I think most people can live without the most high-res screen or the highest refresh rate and stuff like that, if you are getting something that's very nice to look at and hold. And especially, totally. You use this thing every day for 2 years, a lot of people. So they're going to want to invest in something that's thin. And then the other bonus is, if they do chuck a case on it, it's going to be about the same size as a normal phone without a case. So
yes, whereas otherwise cases make phones feel very bulky.
Exactly.
On the battery note, yeah, this is a 4500 milliamp hour battery. So we haven't used it, obviously, but together with the 778G, that should comfortably be a day of use. I would think that would be a day and a half, 2 day use out of the box.
For sure.
So definitely no compromise in battery, which is impressive to get it that thin with the battery that size.
Yeah, the specs, I'm a little surprised by the specs just because it's so similar on paper to the newly launched Mi 11 Lite NE 5G. Uh-huh. The same processor and like all that stuff, and having a thin design. Like, technically I think the Mi 11 is actually slightly thinner.
Very slightly, isn't it? Yeah.
So I guess you are just paying for, and that was already a design-led phone. Like, that's how I reviewed the standard 5G model. Is like, this is the thinnest 5G phone you can get. So it seems odd that they're spinning off a whole separate brand for the first time for this design-led stuff. Okay, it's kind of nice. But I'm just trying to understand why they decided this was the device to do that with.
There are some slightly different touches because, I mean, for example, this one has a curved display.
That's the one thing I'm like, the light, that's why doesn't. They're showing it off, I guess.
And that, at the very least, that is certainly something people associate with being a bit more premium and being a bit fancier. I can't remember how the Mi 11 Lite's cameras would stack up to this. So the camera setup here on the Civi is a main camera that's 64 megapixel and with an f1.8 aperture, but no OIS, which I know the Mi 11 Lite also lacks. And that is, you know, sort of the drawback. And then you're getting an 8 megapixel ultra wide, and then the almost obligatory nonsense 2 megapixel macro that you will never use.
I was going to say depth sensor then.
Yeah, well, those first two sensors are the same on the NE, but there's a 5 meg telephoto macro. Wow. So it's actually slightly better on the NE.
Oh, it's got the telemacro that the Mi 11s use. The telemacro is okay. That's actually a good macro.
Like Instagram worthy. By all means.
So
the camera's a little less good, but I guess that's because you've shaved off some of the edges there to get that thinness, so less room for camera stuff.
They have also, I think, tweaked the design language here. It definitely looks different to the Mi 11 Lite. It feels different. Yeah. It's funny, in the build up to this, one of the big leakers on Twitter and Weibo, Ice Universe, was hyping up that Xiaomi was going to unveil its most beautiful phone ever. And I mean, if you're familiar with Ice Universe, he's a little bit grandiose in his statements sometimes. And it's no exception. He was sort of, you know, most beautiful Xiaomi phone ever. Your jaw will drop. You'll think all other phones are hideous trash once you see this beautiful Xiaomi device. And I know I've already said a lot of the Vivo phones, but it's funny because it dropped. And then everyone said, it just looks like a Vivo X60. And that's good. The Vivo X60 is a beautiful device. And I was a huge fan of the look of the X60, that whole series. But it really, this is exactly the same design language as what Vivo was using earlier this year, late last year, and has actually, funny enough, moved on from slightly in its X70 series. But this looks very familiar to that, with this sort of two-tone stepped camera module and these slightly gradient-y, matte, almost matte frosted finishes on the actual rear.
I do like the finishes seem to be more adventurous than we've seen most Xiaomi phones of late. There's like sparkle in there and some sort of tonal stuff going on, which is quite cool.
In the press images that I've got on my screen, I thought I had a really dirty screen. I didn't realize it was an actual finish. I just thought I needed to wipe my screen a little bit. No, now I know that it's an actual thing. That looks really nice. I'm here for that.
Yeah, I think that's a good.
I found a side-on photo of the Civi to put in the stream, and it looks, I can't believe how thin that looks. I mean, it's obviously helped by the fact that the back's curved towards that metal, that bezel that runs along the middle. But it's,
I mean, you know,
so
in the
clean.
Hand, that edge is going to feel even thinner.
It's
going to
stick.
The phone, actually,
I think it looks lovely. I think you know, like I said, I love the Vivo stuff. If Xiaomi are just going to kind of shamelessly ape that because it was great, hooray, more people making that kind of phone, go for it. The big sadness here is, I think for me, this is a China-only launch, as best as we can tell. Xiaomi has told Android Authority that there are no plans to launch this outside of China, at least for now. So we may never get our hands on one of these.
Nintendo saying that they're not releasing a Switch.
Who knows? And I have seen people point out that even if they never release it as the Civi, Xiaomi does have a tendency often to re-release models internationally with different names. So they're saying they're not going to launch it globally may be true in the sense that it won't be launched with that name, but we might see the same phone turn up as the Mi 12 Lite, or actually the Xiaomi 12 Lite, sorry, or something like that. So we may see this phone turn up elsewhere under a different guise.
Maybe even like the Pocophone Lux or something or other.
Yeah, a Redmi. I could position as a high-end Redmi or Poco. I don't know. Hopefully, I hope we see this. I hope, you know, this is it feels a bit different for Xiaomi. It feels like a shift in their design language. It's obviously a shift in their branding. We've seen them, they dropped the Mi line this year. They're now doing this. They're clearly pivoting the way they, you know, pitch their products. And I hope that sees them tidy things up a little bit. I hope, this is probably me being optimistic, I hope the fact that it's launched on its own with no other variants is a sign that they're going to release fewer variants going forwards, which would be lovely. Maybe the component shortage has limited how many they can produce, and maybe that will have knock-on component effects, because that would be delightful.
Forcing their hand to be more conservative with their releases. Yeah,
I was talking to some people last night, and they, you know, talking about you know, what phones do I recommend, and I was saying, for a lot of people, I think I'd really go for Xiaomi, and then. They were saying, you know, they didn't know that much about Xiaomi products. And I was like, the one thing with Xiaomi is they probably genuinely average two phones a week. And, you know, everyone at the table like looked at me and like gasped in astonishment, like, it can't be. And I was like, you know, they've got the flagship line where you're going to get 10 or so a year. You've got the Redmi, which is going to be 20 to 30 phones. Poco's another 10 phones. You know, like, they probably are at least hitting a phone and a half every week.
Yeah,
average out across
and
the year.
Don't even ask about RAM and storage configurations on each of those.
No. Like... Yeah, exactly. and then every line comes out with a T variant or a Note variant later on. There's all the pros and the lights and everything.
You got a light, yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
I guess
reiterating, if this is a sign of them simplifying a bit and paring back a bit, I think that would be honestly good for them, at least in the international market. But also just as good. It's environmentally, it's terrible to launch such a cavalcade of new devices. So much waste involved.
just encouraging waste, because yeah, you can't do anything else with them. They're not upgradable. They're recyclable, but you can't, not in the way that we want them to be.
Yeah. Oh, I was just going to say, in a, you know, I guess I shouldn't knock it from its approach, because in a world of black rectangles, design led phones, more of those would be great if they are going to play with the formula a little bit more and give something more visually interesting and ergonomically interesting for people. That seems like a good thing, just at the least to know what doesn't work as well as what does.
Yeah, for sure.
Absolutely. And I think we'll see more of this sort of stuff coming. And you know, you could also say design-led phone is fundamentally what the Z Flip is, right? It's the same thing. Compromising on things like battery and camera to just be like, no, this is, but it looks amazing and it's really cool. But we're at that point where that's becoming more feasible, because you know, processors now, mid-range chipsets are fast enough for any average user. We've spoken a lot about camera. The camera in this, it's not phenomenal on paper, but I bet the stills it takes in decent lighting will be exceptional, and everyone will be very happy with them. And the thing is, the camera battle now is about low light. It's about telephoto. It's about these increasingly like fringe edge cases where the top phones can excel, but the average person is going to care less and less about all of that. And so again, this camera, it's not an exciting phone camera. Probably good enough for most people. The battery's good enough for most people. The charging is good enough for most people. So at that point, why not prioritize the look and feel, which actually is where you're going to be able to stand out and make a bigger difference to the typical user, I would guess. Cool. Well, like I said, no expectation right now that we're ever going to see this outside of China, but keep an eye out. Hopefully that changes, or hopefully we see it arrive under a different name. But that was the Xiaomi Civi. Finally, let's turn to today's last main topic, which is the Galaxy S22 series. This is expected to arrive probably next January, though we'll get to that. Obviously, Samsung's next flagship S line. In the news this week, because the usually reliable leaker OnLeaks put out some renders he produced with the help of leaked info he'd received, that basically reveal what he thinks all three of the S22 phones are going to look like. It's a little unexpected in a few ways. The S22 and the S22 Plus look a lot like the S21 and the S21 Plus, which I think is fair, and that's probably what we would guess. There was a fairly big redesign last year, and it's not really surprising that Samsung's decided to just stick with what worked. And I'm sure they'll sort of tweak it a bit more next year. But this one looks pretty straight by the numbers follow up on those models. The only wrinkle is that OnLeaks said that the source actually called the Plus model the S22 Pro rather than the S22 Plus. So there's this weird little wobble of, oh, was that like some error or some internal documentation? Or is Samsung actually going to change Plus to Pro? We'll see. The bigger change is the Ultra, which, for the first time, doesn't look like the other phones in the series. The renders that he shared show a phone that doesn't look at all like the S21 Ultra. Nope. In fact, it looks an awful lot like a Note phone. It's got squared off top and bottom. It's a sort of rectangular slab with fewer curves. It doesn't have that edge cut camera module. Instead, the camera sticks out in this sort of interesting looking P shape. So there's been a bit of debate since on whether it's all one unit or whether there's going to be a gap in between the two vertical lines of cameras. Either way, it's going to be roughly that shape. You know, since then, now a case maker has put out renders showing their case is designed for that shape. So people seem to agree that is broadly the shape it's going to be. Important details are things like there is a space in there for an S Pen to slot into the phone. Nice. You might remember the S21 Ultra had an S Pen support, but it doesn't actually slot the stylus in. Supposedly this will.
But like the Fold 3, you could buy a case that accommodated an S Pen if you really wanted to carry
it around.
So
before you had to buy a case that slotted it in, and they made official ones. Now it looks like it will slot into the phone. Presumably that means it will be sold with the phone, whereas before, again, it was an optional extra. So all of this really puts into the space where, well, this is what the Notes were doing. The design language is now very, very Note. And then there has been a little back and forth between leakers over some saying all of this is because it will be the Note. And apparently there is at least a chance that Samsung is thinking about calling this phone the Note 22 Ultra. So what we'd have is the presumably simultaneous, though maybe not, launch of the S22, the S22 Plus, and then the Note 22 Ultra.
Just drop the Ultra. Just call it the Note 22 at that point.
And maybe they will. Maybe that will. Yeah, it will just be the Note 22. Two S22s and a Note 22. Yeah. It's a little confusing.
It is. But I mean, people have been clamoring for a new Note phone when there were the news that the Note was, you know, canned for this year. There was a lot of disappointed people. I kind of get it. You know, there aren't a lot of phones that do that well. So if you do like a stylus experience on your phone, you've got one fewer option. Yeah. And just off the top of my head, I can't think of another company that does that kind of thing.
It's one of the oddities of the industry that other companies have occasionally dabbled in a stylus phone, but no one else has ever stuck with it, even though Samsung clearly had success. And obviously, to be fair, not so much success that they stuck with it either. They did last year, but
they kind of half-assed it after last year's Note.
But you're right. It is a brand. It's a brand with power that people do like. There is nostalgia is the wrong word because it's so recent. But people are still very fond of Notes, and there were a lot of people disappointed that we saw no Note phone this year. The flip side of that is S series sales have been going downhill, and so maybe they are worried that the S brand doesn't have the cachet it once did, and especially maybe at that top end, maybe Note will be more appealing than S. For its, you know, most expensive, most premium device.
Yeah, I guess I could see next year's lineup being then S22, which is around the same price point as this year, which was impressive because it was a bit cheaper than the S20 series prior.
Yeah.
So still hitting that kind of like upper or lower flagship tier, I guess, pricing. Mm. Then the Pro being the expensive, bigger version of that with maybe a couple extra features. And then the Note being its own thing, if you want the best that Samsung can offer without it being a foldable, maybe that's what the Note becomes.
I imagine that the actual drawing experience on the foldable isn't quite as good as what the Note was, because it's a soft nib.
I went back to the Samsung store just to test that specific thing out, and just the divot in the screen is there, even though like the fact that you can put a pen on the screen at all is impressive.
Yeah,
and it does pressure and it does tilt. It's great for very basic note-taking, sketching and doodling, but nothing more serious. And I'm not saying that the Note is really the answer to that, but the Surface is different and it is arguably better just because it is solid and more stable.
That's what I've got in mind. Like I'd be worried about doing any sustained drawing or shading on a foldable right now with those soft displays. Yeah. Even if I do have a soft nib stylus, it's just, I don't want to play that game.
I'm sure Samsung recognizes that even as it's pushing its foldables hard, and you know, I think it's clear by now we are broadly fans of the new fold and the new flip. There's still going to be a big pocket of people who don't want a foldable.
Yeah.
When I've been playing around with the flip for the last week or so, when I've been showing it, some people are like, "That's really cool. That's amazing. I want one." Other people are like, "Oh, that's cool. I wouldn't buy it." You know, it just doesn't do it for them. They don't see the appeal. They don't get it. It doesn't work for them, and they'd rather the reliability, the durability of a slab phone. They don't want that new point of weakness where the hinge is an extra way you might damage it. No matter how much they build the durability, it's still, there is a new weakness in there. And for a lot of people, that will be a concern.
And even if the Note ends up being like $1,100, the Fold will still be $300-$400 more than that.
Yeah, so absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's fundamentally why they'll never bring the Fold down to that price. At least not for a long time, because they'll want to have this option of a slab at that price that comes in a bit cheaper because it's a slab, and a lot of people will still see that as a very smarter way to spend their money, which I respect. Worth running through some of the other little specs and tweaks we are expecting across the range, other than this question of whether it's S or Note. One thing is the S22 and 22 Plus, those kind of standard ones, look like they're both going to get a little bit smaller than last year's. Slightly smaller displays, so that the S22 is actually now going to come in a little bit smaller in frame than the iPhone 13, I think is quite an interesting move, and I quite like it. And I think it means there's a bigger range across the three. So the Ultra, or whatever it ends up being called, is more clearly bigger than the Plus, which will sit in between. the Ultra though is meant to stay about the same size, give or take.
Because I think there's only 0.1 of an inch between the Plus and the Ultra from the S21 range. I think something like that. They're really close screen size. Is that right?
Yeah. Right now they're very similar. They're 6.7 and 6.8.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
Now the Plus is meant to drop down to 6.55.
Interesting.
Which will set it much clearly as a midpoint of the sizes. Yeah, same size as the Civi. Whereas the S22 is dropping down to a flat 6-inch nice. Bang on, which I think is a smart choice. Batteries are proportionally also getting a little bit smaller, which is a touch concerning from what we've seen. But yeah. Battery life was solid last year, so I'm not too worried about that. Chipset is roughly what you expect, though there is some confusion here. Everyone's expecting it once again to have an Exynos Snapdragon split, Snapdragon 898 or 895 or whatever it's called, the next big flagship from Qualcomm. And then the Exynos 2200 is probably going to be the Samsung chip that goes in. The only oddity here is that it looks like the normal geographic split might change a little bit. Basically down to carriers, because while they were looking at doing the usual, the States gets the Snapdragon and Europe gets the Exynos and things like that, there are some oddities where, say, I think Verizon in the US is apparently pushing to have an exclusive Exynos variant.
Weird.
And China Telecom is also pushing for an Exynos variant in China. I'm not entirely sure why the carriers want Exynos ones.
Yeah.
I don't know what the argument is there, unless it's because they know that this is the chip that will have the AMD GPU on it, and maybe they do know that actually behind the scenes it's killing the Snapdragon and it's going to be the one to get. But it does look like there may be an Exynos version in the US for the first time through Verizon, but we'll see. That's all of this is still undecided for the moment.
You gotta take your hat off to Samsung. A couple of years ago, nobody wanted an Exynos at all.
It was literally
nobody wanted the Exynos one, and now they've really turned things around with this year's range.
I heard about the S21 FE maybe not happening, I was kind of bummed out, because that was the only way really that you were going to get a high end Samsung running a Snapdragon in markets where the Exynos typically lands. So,
Charging is an oddity. We've seen a little bit back and forth in the leaks, and for a while, a lot of leakers were saying that Samsung was looking at 65 watt wired charging speeds, which would basically be the first time they'd looked at really true fast charging in a long time. They obviously got a bit nervy after the exploding phone debacle of a few years ago.
Oh, memories.
A bit tentative about charging speeds. Sadly, now everyone seems to agree they're not doing 65 watt, and they've settled down at 45 watt, but that will be across the range. So that will be a meaningful charging upgrade for the standard S22 at least.
Can you pass some of that onto the iPhone, please?
Yeah. And then finally, camera stuff, which I know is really what everyone cares about with this stuff. We're going to see this sort of what it looks like is the main two are going to be basically the same, and then the Ultra's got its own different setup. The headline news for the standard S22 and the Plus, basically two things. One, a big bump to a 50 megapixel main camera. This is probably the ISOCELL GN5 that Samsung announced recently, but that should be a really, really great sensor for that main camera. Ultra wide staying probably similar, 12 megapixel ultra wide. But then the other big jump is a 12 megapixel 3x optical telephoto lens. So return to genuine telephoto after 2 years of just throwing in a 64 meg regular lens and digitally cropping into it, which was a cheat that they made work very well for them, in fairness. I was always surprised by the results from that lens.
Yeah, the weird.
Yeah. It felt very cheeky, but it did turn out okay photos. But yeah, it looks like they might be returning to a genuine telephoto on the S22, which is I think a good move. And it obviously looks good for them coming off the back of an iPhone where once again there's no telephoto on the base iPhone. Some people have moaned about that. Samsung gets to go in with the S22 and say, hey, same price as an iPhone 13, give or take, but you get a zoom lens with us. It's a pretty easy pitch.
Yeah.
Then let's turn to the S22 Ultra on its camera stuff, which is obviously a little different. There is more debate here. The big debate is on the main lens, where no one can agree on whether it's sticking with the 108 megapixel sensor that we've seen before, but refining it and improving it ever so slightly in whatever ways they manage to do that, or whether it's making a jump to the 200 megapixel ISOCELL HP1 that Samsung unveiled recently. Basically, yeah, different sources are saying one way or the other. They're each saying, no, the other person's wrong. It's definitely this one. It's definitely that one. So we don't know.
I'm always wary when a first gen newer, like typically untouched resolution sensor hits. Like,
yeah.
108 is an impressive achievement in its own right, and that has come a long way. But like, rewind back to the S20 Ultra, that 108 meg sensor was not great. It was problematic for a bunch of reasons, yes. Not just the fact that the 100 times zoom was pointless. Then, you know, they even scaled it back with the 50 times on the Note 20 Ultra, which also had 108 meg sensor. And then they brought it back with the Ultra 21. I'm hoping they go for they stick with the 108 and just make it a better 108 rather than trialing, using this as the test bed for a 200 meg sensor, personally.
I agree. I think that is more likely. Right. Everyone's also expecting that 200 meg sensor is probably going to be in the Xiaomi 12 Ultra, is also sort of hotly tipped. And I essentially think Samsung is going to let Xiaomi figure out how it works first, and then play around with it itself next time round. That seems more likely to me.
Do
but we'll
think
see.
That the phone companies are aware that megapixel count doesn't actually improve overall image quality? There's other things that they can also do to make things look better.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, it's getting to the point of diminishing return, I imagine, at this point.
This, to be fair, this one is quite a cool sensor and it does some clever stuff. So it's a large sensor necessarily. So it actually still gets a decent pixel size, even with 200 megapixels.
Okay.
And what it's capable of doing is doing various different levels of pixel binning. And it's also that's kind of contextual. So it can, in, you know, if you choose to in good lighting, you can take a full 200 megapixel shot. By default, I think it will actually quad bin to 50 meg shots. And then it can nono bin. I think it can even do 16 pixels combined on another level. I'm not sure. I might be misremembering.
Okay.
But for low light, it can kind of, for low light and challenging light, it can step in and pixel bin more aggressively to get results.
I'm just picturing someone who doesn't know about phone camera tech listening into this segment right now and just hearing words like
nona binning. What are you doing to your nona?
Yeah,
but that does sound very impressive. Like that level of versatility in pixel binning, we've never really seen. You know, usually it's it's either you can take a full res image using every pixel on the sensor, or you get one level of binning
at four and one, and that's
amount.
It.
Yeah, four and one or nine and one.
That is it. Yeah, it will do 16 in one pixel binning to shoot at 12.5 megapixel. Which,
for low light, that could be incredible.
Yeah.
Yes, and it sounds like the way they're talking about it, it sounds like it's set up so it will do that automatically. You know, when it's in low light, it will just change the output resolution and automatically pixel bin more aggressively. And you know, at that point, you're effectively getting pretty large pixels because it's 16 in one, which is very impressive.
I would like to retract my earlier statement. This is a very good thing.
Yeah, so it's a cool sensor, but agree, generally high megapixel count is not the be all end all, and there's no guarantee this will put out better results than the 108 sensor they've already been using. Rest of the camera setup is actually fairly predictable. No big changes here. Ultra wide, 3x zoom and a 10x zoom, same as we saw before. There's been a little bit of debate over whether those are 10 megapixel or 12 megapixel sensors for each of those. It's not really a big deal either way. They'll, you know, put out great results. But that camera is the one reason I think they might go 200 is because the rest of the camera setup is on paper very similar to last year's.
Yeah.
And that makes me wonder if that's because they're changing one lens in a big way. But if they're sticking with the same main lens and everything else is still the same, you sort of look and see, how do you sell the camera enhancement this time? What have you done?
I mean, looking at the, as it's fresh on my mind, the Z Fold 2 and the Fold 3, their camera setup sensor-wise are pretty much identical.
Yes.
They did just really pitch that they've worked on their algorithms and that kind of stuff. So if they're willing to do it with that.
Big changes to them. And from what we've leaked, other than the design change and the S Pen slots in, you know, they were introducing waterproofing, the under-display camera.
Other stuff.
All these are the things you could highlight that were cool, big advancements that made you go, and the camera's about the same. It's fine.
Yeah.
It's not obvious from what we've seen on leaks. Otherwise, they've tweaked the design, the S Pen slots in now, and charging's probably going to be slightly faster. They need something else to push this one, especially the Ultra, you know, of all of them. That's the one that needs a big change.
Just touching on charging and back to Lewis, your comment about wishing the iPhone had better fast charging. Someone has apparently independently tested and with a PD charger, the iPhone 13 Pro can do 23 watt charging for a bit until it gets too warm and it turns it down. And the Pro Max can do 27 watt charging and then it turns it down. So even though Apple doesn't say that, that's a cool little extra tidbit that's been discovered this week, which is nice. So if you've got a PD charger that does 30 watts, you're kind of good for extra speeds on the Pro Max.
We've got a MacBook, and, essentially.
Yeah, the fact that Samsung is re-incorporating higher charging speeds again, because it did 45 watt and then it dropped it and topped out 25 for the S21 and Plus, I think.
Yeah.
And then the 45 was like exclusive to the Ultra, or was that I forget now.
The Ultra had 45 before.
Yeah. So bringing that back or spreading it across the whole range would be nicer if they did do that.
They're going to have the challenge there where they're going to be trying to pitch charging's faster, but presumably still not shipping a charger.
Buy a charger,
is going to make it harder for them to lean on that as a big advancement in the phone. Which is, you know, has always felt like, it's funny because it has felt like part of why they were happy to go along with this move that Apple made, and it makes sense for both those brands because neither Apple nor Samsung did fast charging, and so they're the two brands where they could just say, yeah, we're not going to talk about charging anymore. We won't give you a charger and we're not going to focus on it. It's not our thing.
You don't need to
but
charge
now
it.
If they do feel like they need to catch up, it's that they're in a bit of a quandary as to how to message that, I guess. I'm curious how they handle it.
I like the idea, though, that early next year, when this range hits, that the top one is really just a Note, even if it's called the S whatever and not the Note whatever. I think that makes more sense to me, especially now that the foldables are getting... Their foldables are getting good, you know? Like, they're still too much, but they're getting...
Maybe it'll be the S22 Note Edition.
That would make a lot of sense.
I was just thinking they could call it S Note in some way.
Yeah. The Snote.
The Snote.
I think the big challenge for me actually is not even what they call it. It's just this oddity of if they are in the same naming convention, if they are all S22s on some level, they look so different.
Yeah.
You've got two that look the same but different sizes and one that looks completely different.
It looks like the Note 20 Ultra. It looks the same.
It looks like exactly what you would expect a new Note to be. And, you know, you have to wonder, well, was this the Note 21 Ultra that they started building and then it got shifted around and didn't happen and got pushed back? But that's partly why I could believe them throwing the Note name on it, because they don't look like they belong to the same series, assuming these renders are fairly accurate to what the final product will be, which obviously, you know, not guaranteed by any means. But it's going to be a weird one to pitch that these are all variants of the same product line when they look radically different. That does make me wonder slightly if they're going to launch together or if we're actually going to see S22 and Plus arrive together. And then maybe this Note or the Ultra or whatever it is comes a month or two later, which helps them justify setting it apart.
Yeah.
That's what Xiaomi does with its Ultra model. It waits a few months and then releases the Ultra. I wouldn't be shocked if Samsung tried the same.
Samsung has obviously moved up to like a January kind of release, you know, much earlier this year. So that could be a reason to do it. So they take the, you know, just after Christmas, here's January, here's your S22, and then give it till March when other people start to release their products for 2022. And they're like, actually, we've got the Ultra. So
yeah,
there's that.
Yeah.
On that note, there is already some mild speculation that they may be moving the launch to December. Moving it earlier than ever before.
S21 users will be...
Yeah.
And I think part of the expectation is that maybe this is linked to the S21 FE's cancellation. If it is indeed cancelled, you know, they wouldn't want those to run too close together. But if there is no FE, then that pressure is gone. It's worth remembering last year, Xiaomi unveiled the Mi 11 in late December. So they did get out there just before New Year's with their first Snapdragon 888 phone. Everyone's expecting that to happen again this year. And actually, I think an exec at Lenovo said a while ago that we'd see their first Lenovo and Motorola 888 devices this year. So they're also seemingly going to go for a December launch. So we may start to see more and more of these launches happen in December, presumably for January launches, which is fine. I find it odd because for the Western market, that falls into a really funny space around Christmas and the sales periods. And it's a very odd time to launch a device.
Yeah, it sounds problematic from my perspective.
You'd have to get it early enough in December to actually be on sale over Christmas, which really means launching first week or two of December. Mm. But that's difficult because Qualcomm only announces its chip in the first week normally. So the timing is very narrow. Xiaomi announced between Christmas and New Year's and then put it on sale in January. But Christmas isn't a big thing in China. You know, there's a sales period. Yeah. It's not the same concern. For the West, it's the huge driver of when you release all this stuff is working in Christmas and January sales. And launching in December, just you're not going to hit them in a meaningful way. And it sounds like a very odd time to launch a product.
For sure.
So I'm a touch skeptical. Mm. We will see, though. Yeah, we've still got a few months before we find out exactly what's happening with the S22 series. So there's plenty of time to find out how everything we've said today is complete nonsense. OnLeaks was wrong all the way down. All those renders are absolute crap. And, you know, we all look like idiots when these bits of the show are quoted back at us in January. Until then, though, we will be back this time next week to talk about more phone stuff. Again, I'm not really sure what by then we'll have all had some time to play around with iPhone 13s. So we may be talking iPhone 13 opinions across the range because we do have the full set coming towards us. I may talk about the Z Flip, having spent some time with that, or the Vivo X70 series, which, as I said, I have the Pro and the Pro Plus sitting in boxes waiting for me when I have the time to give them my attention. And I'm very excited because I did open the boxes and kind of coo over them a little bit because they look really lovely. Until then, thank you for watching and or listening, and we'll see you all same time, same place next week. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.